This lecture is to discuss some spectral sequences. So let me first there are very general sort of spectral sequences that so I'm going to specialize to a very specific example. So namely, spectral sequences associated with bicomplex. So I think these are the only ones we need. In this school. So a bicomplex is kind of a natural generalization of a complex when you have, instead of a linear thing, you have now a thing in the plane. So you have, you put your objects of an abelian category at the points of some grid. And so the differentials go up and to the right. And so as usual, so there is a horizontal differential, there is a vertical differential, so they both have to square to zero. And now the squares, so here there are two possible conventions which differ by sign. So let's assume here that they skew commute, so dAv dH equals minus dH dV. So one can easily pass from this convention to the convention where they commute by changing, for example, signs in every other column or in every other row. So and we will need to do this at some point. So, but this convention is good from the following perspective. So when you have a bicomplex, then you can form a total complex. Actually, you can do it even in two ways, depending on whether you prefer using direct sums or direct products. So, but this actually already depends on the category you have. So suppose the category, abelian category, has enough, so admits direct sums. So then you infinite direct sums. So then you can form a total complex by taking sums along the diagonals like this. So so C, so you define a total complex. Cn equals direct sum CpQ over P plus Q equals N. And the differential, as a differential, you take the sum of vertical and horizontal differential. And then this convention that they skew commute actually implies that this squares to zero. So if you want this to be zero, so when you unravel this, so this dV vertical square is zero, dH square is zero, and the remaining expression is also zero because of skew commutativity. And so so when you have a bicomplex, you can do the following thing. So suppose you start with a bicomplex, and let's do the following thing. Let's first compute to cohomology of every vertical horizontal of every column. So pass to cohomology in every column. So I replace what I had before by, so in, at the place PQ, I will have cohomology with the number Q of the complex CP star. Right, so here I'll have cohomology with number Q plus 1. And here I have cohomology of the next complex, and so forth. So now, of course, you can observe the following thing, that the horizontal differentials, they almost give, you can view them as something like a chain map of complexes. In fact, they give a chain map not of these complexes, but of complexes where you change the differentials by minus one, by minus the differential. But cohomology doesn't feel this difference, so they still induce the horizontal differentials. They still induce maps between cohomology of different columns. So if you take vertical cohomology at one place, so you apply the differential here. So if you start with a co-cycle here, apply the with respect to vertical differential and apply to it horizontal differential, then due to this q-cumulativity, there will be a cocycle here, and this will induce a map on cohomology. So you'll have this horizontal maps. So, but, so the next thing you can try, yeah, and it still satisfies that d square is zero because the original one had this property. So this composition is still zero. So we can view now, we can get new complexes now, and we can consider their cohomology. So pass to cohomology again. And so you get, again, some picture with objects written on the grid, but now you can observe that you can construct a new differential there, which will work as follows. So let's think a little bit about what is this, how to represent the cohomology of these new complexes here. So here where we had our diagram, so our bicomplex. And so we start, let's just think about kind of co-cycles here, about representatives of cohomology classes in this complex. So first of all, we should start with being an element here. So we should have a co-cycle with respect to vertical differential. So we should have an element here, some x here, which goes to zero under the vertical map. Right, so that would be representative for any element here. Now, the fact that it's a co-cycle for the horizontal differential means that when I take this element under this differential, so it goes to some, I don't know, y, then this co-cycle with respect to vertical differential is going to be trivial. So it has to go to zero by this map. So it means that this y actually has to be a co-boundary with respect to the vertical differential. So there should be some element z here that goes to this y. So now, of course, there's many choices for z. But now what you can do is you can apply the horizontal differential to z. And you'll get some element t here. And now what can you see about this element t? You can see that this element t goes to 0 here, and it goes to 0 here. Because it comes from something here, so it goes to zero here, and it goes to zero here because of skew commutativity of this square. So we know that y goes to zero here, and t goes to zero here. So starting from an element that goes to zero that goes to zero in this direction and becomes a co-boundary when we go here, we construct an element like this. So this means that we actually, in this new, when we pass to cohomology here, we actually will get some kind of map that looks, that has this direction. So, and in fact, if you trace what were the kind of co-boundaries here, you can see that it will give you a well-defined map in like so in the new collection of objects that you get. So when you pass to cohomology in this diagram, and so it actually continues. So if you consider now a co-cycle with respect to cohomology of this differential, then it will amount to having a longer stair, kind of staircase like this. So you'll have an element that goes to something here, that goes to y here, which comes from something here, that goes to t here, which comes from something here. And so the next map will actually be like this, and so forth. So you get a formal structure that looks as follows. So this kind of not bicomplexes, but this collections of objects numbered by the lattice, by the two-dimensional lattice, they form what are called pages of the spectral sequence. So this is the first page called E1. So when you passed, so E1 PQ is what we have here. So it's this guy. So on the next page, so E2 PQ, this is going to be cohomology of this. So it's going to be cohomology with the number P of this complex, of the complex H star of CP of C star. Well, yeah, so anyway, so it's cohomology with respect to the horizontal differential here. And so the point is that so you will get this collection numbered by numbers R equals, well, zero, we can think about this as the just the original complex. And they will have, so on the R-th page, you will have the differential that's given by, has this strange direction. So the differential goes, dr goes from this to p. Let's see. So the first time in the zero, it was, so I think it will be plus r q minus r plus 1. So let's check this. So when r equals 0, the vertical is supposed, so it's supposed to be just vertical differential. So r equals 0, and here we have q plus 1. So this is just vertical. For r equals 1, it should be p increases by 1, q doesn't change. So it goes like this, and r equals 2, it goes like this, and so forth. And so this squares to 0, and the main rule is that when you pass to cohomology, so then you get the next one. So from here, you pass to cohomology. R, and this gives you the next page, R plus 1. And in the good situations, so, and I will describe them precisely, so there should be some boundedness for this bicomplex. So in the good situations, what we will have is that this differentials eventually become 0 at every given point PQ. So we want the situation where, so I assume also that for every given PQ, the differentials coming, so the differentials coming here and exiting here, so they will be 0. So this becomes 0 for large enough Q, for large enough R. So then if this happens, then the corresponding term stabilizes. So when you pass to cohomology here, if the differentials are 0, nothing changes. The kernel is going to be the whole thing. The image is going to be zero. So when you pass to cohomology, this term just doesn't change. And we say that it survives. And so then we get, this way we get the limit. So we get the limit, which is E infinity PQ. So this is the stabilizing value at the point PQ. And so then the claim is that under some conditions, some boundedness assumptions, on the bicomplex, so this limit actually has something to do with the cohomology of the total complex. So this is called total complex, where we sum. So where we sum over over diagonals. So the limit E infinity PQ kind of gives information. Well, it always gives some information, but here it provides more or less complete information about cohomology of the total complex. Of the total complex. Namely, so namely, the total complex has a filtration. So maybe I have C and C, so maybe I should write this as tot C, because otherwise they will not look different. So let me denote it as tot C. Sorry, what was the question? Yeah. I mean this thing as a whole. Yeah, give information about all cohomology. Yeah, but in part, yeah, you're absolutely right. So if you want information about HN, then you would have to look at the corresponding diagonal P plus Q equals N, and so these terms will give you information. Yeah. So see, this total complex has a filtration. So it's, let's call it maybe a column filtration. So namely, we can think about it as a decreasing filtration. So we have, total complex FP. So this would correspond to sum of, or maybe P naught. So this will be when P is bigger than or equal than P naught. Okay, N. So P plus Q equals N, but the main point is that if you look at the picture of the bicomplex, so if you consider kind of everything to the right of some column, then this is going to be a subcomplex because it's preserved by both vertical and horizontal differential. Right, so if you make up some other rules, so for example, if you want to try to do the kind of to the left of this, it won't work because the horizontal differentials will actually move you outside of this. But if you're taking to the right of something when P is bigger than something, then this forms a subcomplex. And this is a filtration by subcomplexes. And so therefore, you get a filtration on the cohomology. On each cohomology. Filtration on cohomology, so the pth term of the filtration on cohomology is, so these are cohomology classes that come from this subcomplex. And so the graded quotients of this, so graded quotient FP over fp plus 1 of this hn of total complex is actually isomorphic to e infinity pq, where q is n minus p. So in other words, yeah, so this is the main, way in which we get information about the cohomology of total complex. And furthermore, under this boundedness assumptions, what will happen is that this filtration will be exhaustive and separated. So intersection of all fp is going to be zero, and union of all fp is everything. So in some sense, so the spectral sequence computes this all these spaces. So to some, at least it tells you the size of the space. So if you can filter it and you compute every associated graded piece and these conditions hold, then you can think that you understand how big is this cohomology. So of course, in particular, this gives you a useful tool for checking that some cohomology are zero. So if you can prove that all these guys are zero, then of course HN will be zero. Okay, so now what are these boundedness assumptions? Yeah, and so we write this in symbols. So when this happens, so we write that E, we usually put here explicitly E1 or E2, so some small number R, so converges, or E2, PQ. So where these guys we can compute explicitly usually, converges to HM, or maybe we can write P plus Q of total C. Yeah, so we say converges. So what are the assumptions? So boundedness, appropriate boundedness assumptions. Well, I'll just write one of them, but there are versions of this. So the boundedness assumption is the following: that if you take any diagonal, so on any diagonal of the bicomplex. So if you fix any diagonal and just go along this diagonal to the right and down, so if you move in this direction, then eventually you should get zeros. So eventually have zeros. So CP Q is zero for P large enough. So for on any fixed diagonal. So for example, this automatically happens. So this is automatic if the bicomplex lies in the left half plane or it lies in the upper half plane or it lies in a first or third quadrant, here or here. So these are usually the boundedness assumptions that guarantee that this convergence holds. Yes.
In this filtration, should we be taking direct sums over all p plus q equals n?
So I took here specific p. Yes, thank you. Yeah, I forgot to write this. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Okay. So. Right, so one can think of this procedure as a generalization as a generalization of a long exact sequence of cohomology for a short exact sequence. So you, if you I think if you're maybe if you're bicomplex, so I think this corresponds to the case when the bicomplex just has two subsequent columns, non-zero, and everything else is zero. But there is actually a generalization of this construction. So notice that here, what is essential here is that this I have this filtration on the total complex by subcomplexes. And in fact, that's the only data you need. So in fact, you don't need to start with the bicomplex. There is a more general construction where you start with a complex that has a filtration by subcomplexes. And then the, there is a corresponding spectral sequence. But the, but the kind of assumptions under which it converges has to be formulated slightly differently. So, right. So I also want to be a little more flexible in how I set this up. So I consider this spectral sequence such that the zeroth differential is vertical, the first differential is horizontal, and then it proceeds kind of along this diagonal. So we have this diagonal here. So the, then you kind of each next differential will hit the next point on this diagonal. But actually, it's sometimes convenient to also consider a different setup where I start with a differential, where I first consider cohomology with respect to horizontal differential, then cohomology with respect to vertical differential, and then I go along the diagonal this way. Of course, the only to go from one picture to another, all you have to do is you have to flip the picture with respect to the x equals y, p equals q diagonal. So so there's absolutely no difference between this case and this case, but somehow for different situations that we will consider, sometimes it's kind of, if you just kind of write the, what you have on the nose, you want to use sometimes this one instead of this one. So to distinguish the two cases, I will just say that here I consider a spectral sequence starting with vertical differential. And here I will say that this is a spectral sequence starting from horizontal differential. Right, because the zeroth differential here is horizontal, and then it goes like this. So of course, when you formulate boundedness assumptions here, you have to flip the assumptions there. So instead of requiring that eventually everything becomes zero on this diagonal, you have to require that everything becomes zero on this diagonal. Okay, so let me give you a first example of a spectral sequence, and at the same time, it will be an example of a bicomplex. So it will be about tensor product of complexes. So let's say we have a commutative ring, and so we consider complexes of R modulus. So we want to define a tensor product of complexes, or R. So, and of course, you immediately see that this has a natural structure of a bicomplex, because there are two indices here. So we can view this as a bicomplex, this tensor product. And the total space of this bicomplex is what is usually called a tensor product. So by definition, this is the following. So when you take nth term here, this is direct sum AP tensor BQ, and the differential works as follows. So A tensor B, where A lives in degree P, B lives in degree Q. So it's defined as dA tensored B plus minus 1 to the P A tensored dB. So this means that, so this minus P is needed in order for D squared to be 0. And so this is what I was telling you before about convention for bicomplexes. So if you just consider the obvious differentials here, so if you take A tensor BQ and write them as a bicomplex, with the obvious differentials that are induced by so vertical differential will be induced by the differential of B and the horizontal induced by differential of A, then of course every such square will be commutative. Right, so if in order to make this Q commutative, you have to change the sign in vertical in every other vertical column. So here we put minus 1 to the P. And then it becomes Q commutative. Right, and so by definition, the total complex associated with this bicomplex is what is usually called the tensor product of two complexes. So now I want to prove the following fact using spectral sequences. So I want to prove that if I have a bounded above complex of flat modules, well, for example, projectives will do. So suppose A So assume A is a flat, is a bounded above complex of flat R modules. So flat means the tensoring with each term AP is a flat R module. So tensoring over R with this module is an exact functor. So for example, projectives would have the property like this. So, and suppose B is a cyclic complex with no boundedness conditions. So it has no cohomology, a cyclic complex of R modules. Then the claim is that the tensor product of these complexes is also a cyclic. So this statement, for example, is useful when you try to define the derived tensor product of two complexes, because what you can do then is you can replace one of the complexes by, so if one of them is bounded above, then you replace it by bounded above complex of flat R modules, and then you use the natural tensor product just on homotopy category given by this. By this rule, with this kind of flat resolution. And then it shows that it preserves being acyclic, which means that tensoring with such complex also preserves quasi-isomorphism. So corollary of this is that if B1 to B2 is a quasi-isomorphism, then the same is true for A tensor B1 going to A tensor B2. Because this construction of tensor product, you can check it commutes with the cone. So if this is a quasi-isomorphism, so you look at the cone is acyclic, and then you check that the cone of this is actually the same as A tensor the cone of Q. So this and then apply this property. Okay, so how do we apply the spectral sequence in this case? So we look at this bicomplex here, right? And So we first take a homology in vertical direction. So we have so E1 PQ here is going to be cohomology of Q of the complex AP tensor B. But now we use an easy fact that that tensoring with a flat, well, it's more or less a definition. So tensoring with a flat complex preserves exact sequences. So by definition, tensoring with flat complex preserves short exact sequences. But you can, if you have an acyclic complex, you can split it into many short exact sequences. In this way, you see that, so because B is acyclic and AP is flat, it follows that these guys are actually acyclic. So in fact, this is zero. So therefore, the infinity is also zero. So we check our boundedness assumption. So this is why we need A to be bounded above. So our complex is, in fact, in the left half plane. So the boundedness assumption is satisfied. So therefore, the sequence converges. So we derive that cohomology of the tensor product is also zero. Okay, so next I want to consider a more general setup with the composition of derived functors. Well, actually, maybe even before that, just with the derived functor and applying a derived functor to a complex. So given some F between abelian categories, which is, say, left exact, and suppose we have some bounded below complex of over A, so bound below. And so suppose we have enough injective objects, so we have a derived functor, right derived functor from the derived category of A to derived category of B of bounded below complexes. And so suppose we, so the question we can ask is how to compute the result of applying the derived functor to given complex A. So, and more precisely, so this is again a complex over B, or rather an object of derived category. So we can consider just its cohomology. So it's a well-defined, these are well-defined objects of B. Okay, so we start with some complex of A, and then we want to compute cohomology of its derived functor, which are objects in B. And so where can we start? Well, we assume that we know the usual classical derived functors of F, which we can apply to various objects of A. So the input is we can compute. So we kind of assume that we can compute classical derived functors R I F applied to various objects of A. So for example, we can apply them to either to the terms of the complex, or we can compute them applied to cohomology of the complex A. So suppose we know either these or these, so then how can we compute this cohomology? So the answer is given by a certain spectral sequence. So there are, in fact, two spectral sequences that compute this cohomology. One of them starts from objects from these guys, and the other starts from these guys. So the answer is given. So there are two spectral sequences. And that's actually one of the reasons I wanted to have both these pictures allowed, because one of them starts with vertical differential, another starts with horizontal differential, and the same bicomplex. So what you have to do is this. So you have to, so remember, in order to calculate derived functors, we consider injective resolutions. But here we have not just one object of A, but we have a whole complex. So somehow we have to coherently choose injective resolutions of all the terms of this complex. And this will give us a bicomplex. So the idea is that we take, so we can construct kind of a bicomplex injective resolution. Injective resolution of A. So namely, so our complex looks like this. So P, P plus 1. And so for each term, we will have an injective resolution, IP0, IP1, so on. And they will form a bicomplex. So furthermore, one can actually do even better. So furthermore, one can do it in such a way, can assume that once we take cohomology in horizontal direction, so here we have, that if we take some column here and take cohomology in horizontal direction, so I P star with respect to horizontal differential, then these actually are, this will have the remaining vertical differential between them. So this is also complex with respect to vertical differential. So what we actually get, these are going to be injective resolutions of the pth cohomology. So for each p, this complex, which is obtained by taking cohomology here in the horizontal direction, here in horizontal direction, and so forth, and putting them together in a complex, this will be a resolution of the HP of the complex A. So such, so when you can do this, this is called Cartani-Limbert resolution. And actually, we have a sequence of exercises, maybe unfortunately for the dual picture with projectives, where you are led to the proof of this fact, how to construct such resolutions. All right, so notice that this bicomplex, because A was bounded below, so the bicomplex IPQ, so this bicomplex actually lives in the first quadrant. Well, maybe with some shifts. So, right, because the complex is bounded below, and then we also take, so injective resolutions go only in the vertical direction. So therefore, boundedness assumptions are satisfied. So one more thing you can check, so one can check that the total space, totalization of this complex, which actually has a natural map to A, so that this is still a resolution. So this is actually quasi-isomorphism. So therefore, when we compute, when we consider derived functor of A, this can be computed, right, derived functor of F applied to A, this actually can be computed as F applied to this injective resolution. So we just apply F to the totalization of I. But of course, this F is just applied term-wise. So this is the same thing as the totalization of the bicomplex, where I just apply F to every term of this injective bicomplex resolution. So I take this bicomplex of injective objects and apply F to every term. I get a new bicomplex. And so what I'm interested in is actually nth. So this nth cohomology of this guy, we're actually interested in nth cohomology of this totalization. So there is a standard. So from here, we get that. So here we have two spectral sequences which start. So two spectral sequences. So one starts with horizontal differential, and another starts with vertical differential. So it's easy to see explicitly what is the beginning page of this sequences. So for one of them, so if we just take, if we start with a vertical differential, so if start with d vertical, so then what happens is that we first take a cohomology in every column here. So what happens when we do this? We're just computing in every column where we have injective resolution of the corresponding term of A. So we're just computing derived functors of the pth term of the complex. So we get term E1 PQ equals RQF applied to AP. Okay, and this converges to HN of RF. So if we start with horizontal differential, so then at the first page, we will get injective, according to this assumption, we will get injective resolutions of cohomology of P. And so at the second page, we apply, we can compute cohomology of those injective resolutions. So we get that E2 PQ will be RQ of F of HPA. And this also converges to the same cohomology, but note that these are different kinds of spectral sequences. So this one, for this one, differentials go like this. So for this one, the differentials go like this. And so it also implies that the filtrations that you get in the end also behave a little differently. So in one case, we take filtration. So here, we take filtration corresponding to subcomplexes given by columns. Here, we take filtration corresponding to subcomplexes given by rows, right? Because the two pictures are flips of each other. So yeah, but I'm kind of, yeah. So I want to kind of preserve a little flexibility here. Yeah. Yeah. So indeed, in some books, when, instead of writing this, you will just see pink. You switched, and then this becomes the standard, standard type of spectral sequence. Okay. So let me now apply this to some geometric examples. Okay, so first let's consider a Lyrae spectral sequence. So this is this spectral sequence uses the fact that when you have, so you suppose you have x goes to y goes to g goes to z, and we have f and g. And I think F G goes first, F goes second. So we have that R F composed with G is composition of derived functors. And so this means that suppose I now have sheaf on F, right? And so the idea is that somehow I'm interested in the composed map, and I want to calculate higher direct images of F with respect to composed map, right? So this is kind of typical situation. So we have maybe a complicated map from X to Z, and we kind of split it into more easy maps, G and F. So, and we want to understand derived functors of the higher derived direct images with respect to the composed map of F. So we want to calculate Rn of F composed with G star. Sorry, I forgot to put star here. So I'm talking about the direct push, about the derived push forward. So this goes from, so these are from the quasi-coherent sheaves on X to quasi-coherent sheaves on Z. Right, so suppose I have some quasi-coherent sheaf on F, on X, and I want to calculate these high direct images. So I know that this is the same as nth cohomology of the corresponding complex derived push of the derived functor applied to F, which I can calculate in this way. So this is Hn of R F star applied to R G star F. So this is actually the situation that I had before. So this is my complex A. And this is the functor F, right, in the previous situation. So this is the functor of which I take derived functor. And then I want to calculate nth cohomology of this derived functor applied to some complex A. So if I apply the second spectral sequence here, I will get that I need to calculate cohomology of A, and then I need to calculate cohomology of, and then I need to compute classical derived functors of this applied to cohomology of A. But cohomology of A, this is precisely piece derived images with respect to morphism F, with respect to morphism G of the sheaf F, right? By definition. So the second spectral sequence, so which starts with horizontal differential, so it has E2 PQ equal RQ F star applied to RP G star F, and it converges to what we need, but it starts with horizontal differential. Yeah, by the way, Leray did this work. Well, he actually did something. He started with a kind of much less abstract picture with topological spaces, and the sheaves were constant. But it's interesting that he did this work while he was a prisoner of war in Austria from 1940 to 1945. And before war, he actually was a great expert in PDEs. He was world's leading expert in Navier-Stokes. And he was afraid to work on PDEs because he thought that the Nazis would think it's something applied. So they would apply him to something. So he switched to topology as a safe subject. And after war, like, he waited for some time. And in 1950, he went back to PDEs. Okay, so, right, so I don't have time, unfortunately, to calculate some example. So let me actually do now another example with, so the next example will be local to global X. Right, so suppose we have some sheaves, F and G, some quasi-coherent, well, maybe coherent sheaves on some scheme X. So then we can calculate. So then we have this kind of sheafified R home from F to G, which is so it's obtained by taking, for example, injective resolution of G and applying sheafified home to it. So this is direct. So this is derived functor which takes values in complexes of quasi-coherent sheaves on X. And so as Nick explained, so when you take global sections, derived functor of global sections of this, so this is going to be, so the this is going to give the usual R home, not sheafified. And so one can again use this to calculate. So if I have some concrete sheaves, I want to calculate. So the cohomology here, so if I pass to ith cohomology, this is the x I. So xn fg, this is nth cohomology of this guy. So it becomes nth cohomology of the complex r gamma x applied to r home. So it's again in the same format as before. So we need to calculate. So cohomology of this functor will be local x, and so we will have cohomology of this functor. This is HQ with values in x. So we will have a spectral sequence starting from these guys and converging to the straight x from f to q. And so here is a quick example of how this can be used. So suppose you have X is smooth variety over K, or maybe smooth. Yeah, smooth variety over K, algebraically closed field, and you have some point. So closed point. And then so then you have the corresponding skyscraper at the point P, which I will just write as OP. So some people denote it as K of P. I don't know. So this is a skyscraper at the point P. So if X is affine, then this is corresponds to the module, which is ring module of the corresponding maximal ideal. So then I suppose I want to calculate X from this structure shift to itself. So the problem is that X can be kind of big, and you only have a nice resolution of this locally. So, but you can solve this problem using the spectral sequence. So we have spectral sequence starting from curly X from OP to OP. And then we take cohomology of these guys. So now what happens in this case is that this X, they're all going to be supported. So this is going to be sheaf supported at P. So this is a general property of the curly X functors. So, well, you can, for example, do it as follows. Replace OP by locally free resolution. So then you apply homes. And then you just need the same property for homes when one of the arguments is supported at P. So then the home is still supported at P, is just because it's killed by all the equations that define P. So and then when you have a sheaf with pointed support, then it has no high cohomology. This implies that HQ X XP OP OP is going to be 0 when Q is bigger than 0. So So this means that when you look at, so this is a term E2. So in the corresponding spectral sequence, the term E2 is just on one line, Q equals 0. So everything else is 0. And in term E2, the differential already looks like this. So you see that all the higher differentials are going to be 0 because they either come from 0 or they go to 0. And so this means that the sequence, what we say, degenerates at the term E2. So when starting from some point, all differentials are 0, we say that the spectral sequence degenerates. So therefore, now you, this is already E infinity. Now, when you remember the connection with this guy, so this has a filtration such that associated gradient live on this diagonal. But each such diagonal intersects our line in exactly one point. So it means that this filtration on the on this guy actually has just only one non-zero subquotient. So this, in fact, is isomorphic to H naught of X, XP, LPP, NP. And so the local X you can easily compute because to compute local X, you can shrink X. So you can consider a fine neighborhood of the point, and you can even shrink it further. So you can assume that your point is given by 0. You can kind of find n. So if n is X is n dimension, you can find n equations. So it will be like given by regular sequence. So there will be Kazule complex. So P will be given by zeros of some regular sequence of n functions. And so the corresponding Kazule complex will be a resolution. Using this Kazule complex, you compute this X, and you just get an exterior algebra in n-dimensional space. And so the H naught actually, for pointed shifts, it doesn't change anything. So it's just going to be. So the answer is that these guys are given by. So the X between OP and OP, they're just given as exterior algebra on the tangent space of X at the point P. So there is a little more to this that you can say. So because this has also an algebra structure, you can check that the algebra structures are the same. But this is already more fine details. So I'll stop here. And